Time's to start. Oops. Well, hello everyone. Thank you so much for joining me here today. It's really a pleasure that I can hold a presentation about one of my favorite topics in FHIR, which is searching in FHIR resources. So this talk is all about how you as a client developer can specify what information are vital to use cases, how to transform that into a search request and retrieve all the content necessary from a FHIR server for your use cases. Of course, this is quite a broad topic, so we will have a lot to talk about in the next 30 to 35 minutes. First, we are going to start with a basic introduction to the most fundamental aspect of the FHIR Search API. So if you're new to FHIR, don't worry, we will get you covered here. Afterwards, we will move over to the more advanced concepts in the FHIR Search specification. So hopefully at the end of my talk, you will have a clear picture in mind what you can and can't do within a FHIR Search request. There's also a section about some tips and tricks. I've put together a collection of links and further literature. So if you're interested in the overall topic, please check that out in detail. Of course, throughout the presentation, we want to focus on some practical examples. But unfortunately, due to time constraints, we can't really do this in a live interaction, and I can't really help you out with your use cases. But I prepared a small quiz, which you can download now from the DevDay site. So afterwards, I invite everybody to join me at one of the hands-on tables so we can do some live hacking and discuss every question you may have about this presentation in more detail. Before we get started, two sentences about me. My name is Alex Saltke. I'm currently working for Filey in Amsterdam. I've recently joined the Vonk server team. And last year, I was, so to say, sitting on the other side of the room. I was part of the one of the student teams here at the student track at DevDice and got thankfully picked up by Filey and got the incredible opportunity to write my master thesis also about the FHIR Search framework at Filey. Down here is my email address, so if you have any questions after this presentation, after DevDice, please feel free to drop me an email. And with that, I would say we get started. So, as you all know, FHIR is all about exchanging resources between clients and servers and any kind of architectures that you may find useful. And in many of these use cases, it's a requirement that you need to really specify what you are trying to request from a server in a very fine granular way. And for that, FHIR provides the FHIR Search API, which can be found at this link. And today's talk is all about this page, this specification, which allows you to retrieve specific FHIR resources from a server based on their content properties, as well as their structure properties, meaning how they are connected to other FHIR resources. And that's quite an important addition to the normal REST API, because I'm not telling you anything new when I say that searching is an integral part of many medical use cases. We can come up with hundreds of examples in which there are some kind of searching in a workflow, but I don't want to do that now. The interesting bit here is that in most use cases, the implementation cost would increase dramatically if we wouldn't have a server-side searching functionality, because we would need to grab quite large chunks of data, transfer it to the client, process all the data, and then display only the bits and pieces that we want to the client. But luckily, FHIR provides a solution for that, and that's the FHIR Search API, meaning that you can, well, we could call them filters. And here is a blueprint for how to specify a search request which you will most likely to encounter. First, here you have the base URL, which is the server's address of the FHIR server. And if you're using one of the popular FHIR servers like Harpy, Vonk, Wildfire, they implement the FHIR Search API in quite a broad way. So basically, you're good to go. Afterwards, you can specify what you are searching on. Normally, this is just a resource of some type, But there are also different options to which we will get later on. And afterwards, you can pass key value pairs as, well, they are kind of a filter. And I can ask them, the Fire server, hey server, please give me all the resources that conform to this kind of description. And I can specify parameters based on their content. So I could ask for a patient resource with a certain name and some address, or also through structure properties, give me all patients that are somehow connected to an observation. Now, the question is, what can I pass as a fire search request, as a parameter in a request? So, unfortunately, we can't search on every property of a fire resource. That would be awesome from a client-side perspective, because it would give us quite a flexibility. But of course, we need to also see that from a server-side perspective, because we want to search to be fast, and for that to be, we need indexing on the server. And we can't really index everything, because then our index would outgrow our data. So, also, Fire tries to hit here a sweet spot between convenience for the client and implementation flexibility. And so every Fire resource defines its own search parameters, which are kind of an abstraction over the Fire resource elements. So at each page, I always have the same layout. A search parameter has always a name, a type, description, and expression. And the most interesting bits here are the name and the expression. The name is what I pass as a value, as a key in my search parameter. And the expression is telling me in a machine-readable way what the Fire server is then searching on. And it's a Fire pass expression through which I'm navigating through the Fire resource and selecting exactly that element that is supposed to be searched on. And here we are sometimes noticing that the search parameter is an abstraction over the Fire resource element, because sometimes we are actually searching on multiple elements on the same time in a Fire resource within a single search parameter. And afterwards, I can send then the search request to the Fire server, which is returning me a bundle with references to Fire resources that conform to the descriptions provided as search parameters. One important thing is the Fire Search API, as you can see here, only allows you to add you have an AND combination, a logical AND, and you can't really say, please give me all patients that have this name or this address, only AND this address. The Fire Search API is quite complex, so I try to come up with an overview of all the functionality within the Fire Search framework, and you can cluster it in four ways. So we have the search interactions, which are basically the endpoints where I can send a search request to. I have the search parameters itself and some rules about them. And I have this huge chunk here about advanced search concepts that we will cover later on. And I always have a type. So every search parameter in Fire is actually typed. But we come to that later on. Now, exactly, before we move on, one thing, everything in the Fire Search framework is completely optional from the Fire's specification perspective. So a server is not really mandated to implement everything, but it can pick and choose the elements that it wants to implement and that is needed for the use case. And It also means that if something is not provided within the File Search framework, there are many options on how to extend it. So, for example, if a resource doesn't provide you the element that you want to search on, you can define your own search parameter and implement it in your server for your use case, and then describe it in an implementation guide so other people can also use your search parameter. Now, to finish the resource specific search request, we always target a single file search resource. We have an AND combination, and here we see why it's needed that a file search parameter is typed. Because in Fire we have quite a complex type system on primitive types. There are multiple instances which could be logically grouped. For example, we have time, date, daytime, and instance as something that represent a time or date. And from a search perspective, it makes sense to just group them as a single logical group. So, or if we take, for example, everything that has a code somewhere, we have coding, codable concept, and code itself. And this is being grouped in the file search request as a token. Of course, there are some types that have a one-to-one representation like string, but most of them are grouped somehow. That's the reason why we don't use the file resource elements itself, but also have the search parameters. In some use cases, it's really tricky to always know what exactly you want to search on. Maybe you just have an ID or know that you have somewhere a resource that conforms to a profile, and you don't really want to know the type or don't have the type available. And for this use case, Fire allows you to search on all resources stored on a Fire server. So you're actually executing the request not against a resource type, but against directly the base URL of the Fire server, like presented here. And because all Fire resources share some kind of metadata like ID, security labels, the profile, we can search on these kind of things. And there are some useful examples here. For example, if I want to have all file resources that conform to a profile defined by HS7, then I could execute that and I would get back everything. And also last updated in combination with count parameters are quite useful in many use cases. So please keep it in mind that you not always need to specify the resource type, but can actually use the base URL for searching. But one important thing here is you can't then also use the resource specific search parameters, but only the search parameters that are shared between all resources. Lastly, there is also the search interaction, which we call compartment. A compartment is like a logical group which are defined by incoming references. So for example, we have the patient compartment, which includes every resource that has somehow a reference to a specific patient. And I can execute a search against a compartment. So if I want to have every resource that is referencing a specific patient, I could say base URL compartment, which is basically patient, slash ID, which is the ID of the patient that I'm looking for, and then the literal character of a star, and I will get back a bundle with every resource that has a reference to this patient. And I can additionally filter this compartment by providing a list of resource types here. So if I don't need to have every kind of resource in that compartment, I can also just reduce the result set here. Unfortunately, because of the heavy implementation cost of a compartment on a server, there is no custom compartment definition. So you can only use the ones defined by H7, which is a finitive list. But for most use cases, we have compartments and counters and so on. So you are not likely to run into some issues there. Yes. So here is a complete example. So patient, I have the ID example, and I'm searching on an observation that is connected to this specific patient. And I can also then provide some search parameters on that observation to reduce the result set a bit further. Now, one additional thing that is often overlooked but quite important are modifiers within the file search framework. And every search parameter has a type and has a expected behavior attached to this type. So we think that every search on a string should exactly behave the same. But with modifiers, you can alter that behavior. Because in some cases, you don't really or cannot provide the specific arguments to that type that is expected. So for example, if I normally want to search on a code, it would be expected that I pass a specific code and the code system in which the code I'm expecting that code to be. But if I don't have that code, I can, for example, pass a text modifier to my code element, and then it will search not on the code itself, but on the display value of that code. Also, quite useful is the not modifier, which basically inverts the meaning of the code, so every resource that has not this code specified here by Loink. Every resource, as you can see here, has a missing modifier, which basically means give me all resources that don't have any value within that resource element, and I will get back these resources. And on string types, we have contains, which basically is a pattern matching inside of the string. And also on tokens, some of the useful terminology modifiers, but there are probably other talks that explain them a bit more in detail. So we're not going to cover that. One more thing, please note that the not modifier is defined on a token and not on all search types. So I can't say, please give me all resources that have not a string of type test or something. Only not is allowed on a token. Lastly, what is defined for a search parameter is a prefix. And prefixes can be used for quantities, numbers, and dates. Basically, just the relational operator based on which the value of my key value pair is being evaluated on the server. For quantities, I have all that is expected to be possible to specify within a certain range. And for date, it's quite useful to know that there is a starts before and ends before prefix. So I can also check for time ranges. Also, as you can see here, we have an approximate prefix for quantities. So I can always search on, for example, on observations within a specific range. And I not always have to match exactly the quantity within my file resource to get it back, because we don't always have exactly that value, and a concrete match would not really be useful. So that's for the basic or fundamental aspects of a search request. Let me quickly check the time. Do you have any questions so far about this part of a search request. Yeah, please. You can't do multiple modifiers on a basically you can't do multiple modifiers. So if you are searching on a code with the text modifier, you can't do a contains because it would be too difficult to parse the modifiers. That adds too much complexity, basically. Yeah, would be useful. And we get to a solution later on, because you could do that with an underscore filter expression. But we will get to that in the more complex section. Yeah, please. So the question was just for the video, if there is any experience for larger data sets for querying this. It's kind of tricky to implement, because if you have many resources of a specific type, you have many of the search parameters, and you need to index them, you need to index them in a good way, and I'm sure there are some implementers here who have more experience with that. And it's kind of tricky, because your index keeps growing and you need to all do some tricky stuff to make this all work. So yeah, it's a challenge, definitely. But there are probably better ways to search on a large data set. So this is really meant for selecting specific stuff. And if you really know a certain ID or a connection to a different resource, and just filter out a specific resource, but not to explore a data set. There are other solutions available for that. Yeah. Okay. Any more questions? No. Then we move on to the advanced section. So, for the advanced stuff, it's really useful, because we don't always want to search on the content of a resource, because we might not always have an idea what the content is about, but we have most likely an idea how the resources are connected to each other. And for that purpose, FHIR defines some search operations, because FHIR is all about connecting resources. And in many use cases, we have a network somehow bundled together, as shown here, which also contains often multiple links to different resources. So from a server-side perspective, for example, if we can go from an observation through the search parameter subject to a patient. So subject is here a search parameter of type reference, which searches on the reference value directly on in the resource element. But I can also be more specific and have a patient observation reference. The difference between here is, again, that search parameters are an abstraction over the resource elements. So subject is not only looking for the patient reference, but has an OR combination of multiple other resource targets that could also be the end of that search. So let's start with chaining. A chained request is for traversing a reference in a forward direction. Basically, we want to go from from the target or the start of a search to a different resource, which are somehow connected through some references. And in this case, I want to have back a resource. So the expected resource type in my search request bundle is an observation. And afterwards, I go from observation to encounter to a patient. And here you see again that subject is not clearly defined. So I need to pass a type modifier here, also separated with a colon, meaning that subject is really a patient that I'm looking for, not some kind of other resource. And from that, I'm jumping directly to a general practitioner, which I then can, at the end, search on to, again, reduce the result set a bit more. And all these steps for traversing one reference in the follower direction are chained here together. And I'm going from a search parameter of type observation to the subject with of type patient, and I'm searching then through a reference which is defined on that patient here, move over to the general practitioner, and then search on a search parameter which is defined on that general practitioner. In the other direction, we have reverse chaining. So reverse chaining is for checking if there is a reference somehow incoming to my resource that I'm expecting in my search. So for example, here I have an encounter defined. I'm saying I want to have a reverse chaining search, which is indicated by underscore has. And afterwards I'm checking if there is this encounter is somehow connected through an observation, through the reference found in the search parameter encounter. Please note that this is the search parameter encounter and not the reference element of that resource. And I'm again restricting the search through a search parameter defined on the last type that I have in my reverse chaining search. Similar here for the chaining, it's important to know that you always search on the last type of the resource. So here in this case on the practitioner, so the last element that you have here is on the practitioner, and here the last element is on the observation. And you will get back all the encounters that are matching this reverse chaining chain. Important to know is that only the encounter is being returned and not the observations that I chained over through my search parameters. If you want to do that, you would need include statements and ref include statements. So basically, if we have chaining, we can do includes to include forward references in my result set, and I can do a ref include for including, so basically in the inverse of a reverse chaining search, to include also the resources that have a reference somehow to my expected resource type for a reverse chaining search. So for example, here we have some concrete requests. I have a medication statement, and I want to include a resource which is referenced through the medication search parameter within that medication request. Also for ref include, I'm searching on patient and want to include also all provenance resources that are connected to this patient through the target reference. The advantage obviously is here that I save multiple requests because I can do reverse chaining and chaining searches, but also directly include all references that I also want to have in my result set and not again execute a cert on that particular target or this one in a chain search. Lastly, there is also the underscore type parameter, which comes quite handy in combination with a base search. So against the base search, I can execute all searches with the common search parameters, but I can also specify underscore type and pass a list of resource types, like patient and observation, and then search on all commonly shared search parameters between those types found in the list of underscore type. So for example here, I have condition and observation and counter all share a identifier and which can be found through a chain search on patient. So condition, observation and encounter have a field which is called patient, and the patient has an identifier. So it allows me to search on these three resource types independently of the common search parameters that are already defined on the base search. But all other search parameter values would be rejected with just an HTTP 400 error, basically saying you're not allowed to execute a search because it would be quite difficult to look for every search parameter in every resource. Composite search parameters are defined by the FIRES specification, but unfortunately they are not that widely implemented. Harpy does, and the official FIRE reference server implements, and also we are going to cover them. We are still going to cover them, but please keep in mind that they will not always work in every situation. So a composition search parameter is for you to search on two search parameters values directly in combination. So for example, here we have an observation query which searches on a code and a quantity in combination. So I'm searching on a code on observation which has a code which is coded by this loin code here, but I also want to have the observation this quantity as a as an element value somehow. In some cases this is quite the same as I would just say search on observation code and also on observation quantity. We could do that because it was just an AND combination of the search parameters. But in some cases we would get back different result sets if we would execute the search on these parameters individually. So for example, we have here defined a group which has some characteristics. And I want to have all the groups that have the characteristic gender specified with the value mixed, and also the owner of the group, and that name is Peter. If I would combine them with an AND search, both on characteristic value, this one on characteristic value, and on owner equals Peter, then it would allow me to get back groups that have an owner which is named Peter, but gender would not need to be mixed. So with a composite search parameter, I can enforce that the values should really stick together as a group. Lastly, there is underscore filter. Again, with the search parameter values, the composite search parameter values, It's not that widely implemented, unfortunately, but it would allow you to have a really advanced Swift syntax. Basically, it's freely defined from the rules that we have in the Search API right now. It's a separate page moved out of the Search specification, and it allows you to define more complex combinations of the search parameters. Basically, allow you to have complete all the complete logic elements. You could do negations of every resource element. So, for example, here we could say we have a performer with a name, and that name is also defined as a search parameter of type string, but I can negate them and say not equal tot. And I can negate every filter. So it's recursively defined as filter and filter, or filter or filter. So I directly have support for logical ORs. And afterwards I can say always I have a parent pass, which is either a search parameter directly, or a chained search, or a reverse chaining search. And I have a compare op, which is one of these operators. Most of these are directly related to a modifier within the normal Search API. And then I have a comparison value for that. And basically, it would allow me to combine all kinds of filters because of the recursive definition, and I can do really advanced lookups of specific file resources. And basically, that's every feature that is within the File Search API. There are still some missing features which are often requested, but as you saw, there is already quite some specification work within the API, so the core team doesn't really want to grow the specification. So these missing things should be kept in mind. It should not be used, as we discussed before, as an analytics tool. There are the guys from Google doing SQL and file stuff, BigQuery, and there are more advanced tools to do that. It doesn't have support for subqueries. So I can't say select a specific patient and then search using that patient in a different resource. I can't express that. And it also has limited support for recursion. If you really want to do that, there is SQL as a more advanced logic expression mechanism. But there's also, as I said before, different vendors with different APIs for more advanced analytics stuff. If you want to know about these analytics, there is the SQL on Fire proposal, which can be found, I guess, in the Zulip chat if you are searching for that. Also, there is an awesome open source project, which is called Bunsen, which allows you to do analytics based on Fire data. And there are some talks at DevTales which are really useful for analytic purposes. So if you're interested in data science, go check it out. Also, here are some more links about the search specification. There, we at Firely have the Profiling Academy, which provides you with an overview of the Search API. Also, if you follow this link here. And as I said before, I provided a quiz. So if you want to do now some hands-on work and start to create a search request and want to query a file server, please join me outside at the developer track. And there we can discuss any more question that you have. And with that, I would say thank you for joining me here. Any questions? Yeah, please. Sorry, come in. Oh, data. Yeah. I know that the underscore footer definition is inspired by OData, and also the underscore text for full text search is also relying partially on this specification, but there is not really much of an overlap or support besides this logical reference to each other. So nothing really. Yeah. Please. Yeah.
Give me only the last one, but I don't know the date. So how can I search on that? Only the latest observation of that patient.
In the case of observation, there is a custom operation defined, which is called last n, which you can execute directly on the observation, and you will get back the latest observation if you specify the parameter then correctly. Else, there is a count modifier and a sort search parameter. So if you have some way of identifying what is the criteria for latest, then you can sort on that criteria and also just limit the search to a specific amount of resources. Any more questions? Then please join me outside. Thank you for listening.